There are many aspects to optimal athletic performance. One of the most overlooked is the warm-up. It is something that, if done right, can greatly improve performance and reduce injury without a big time commitment. And I really want to stress that this is for both the body and the mind. This video will talk about science-backed strategies to get the most from your warm-ups. We will talk about why exactly warm-ups are important, define some terms that are used when discussing warm-ups, give you a strategy on how to warm up, and the common pitfalls to avoid. Also, as a bonus, at the end of this video, there will be a recording of a mental warm-up that you can try out. I'm Dr. Lucius Pomerantz, a board-certified orthopedic surgeon, which means I fix things that athletes break. And I am personally still in the game of trying to keep my body moving and try to use this stuff daily. If you have not watched my videos before, I am trying to bridge the worlds of orthopedic surgery and combat sports. So please like, share, subscribe. You know the deal. All right, there are many things that contribute to best performance in sports or surgery or anything else, really. I did a video that discussed a few of these things in my athletic speed video, which talked about muscles, our nervous system, and learning. Check it out. This video will focus on the warm-up, a part of performance that a person can get a lot of benefit in a short period of time, if done right. Warming up has been scientifically proven to improve athletic performance and reduce injuries. Let's talk a little bit about that evidence. First, warming up makes you warm. Well, this is important because it has shown that by raising the temperature of your muscles 1 degree Celsius, 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit, you can enhance muscle performance 2 to 5%. This is done through multiple mechanisms, including improving muscles' oxygen use, metabolism of energy, and shunting blood flow to those muscles. Also, theoretically, the muscles and tendons and ligaments all become more compliant or stretchy and less likely to be torn or injured. Passive warming, like sitting in a sauna or a hot shower or having heated clothing, has been shown to improve muscle performance. However, I will argue that you will get more benefit faster by doing active warm-ups. This becomes more apparent when talking about the second main benefit of warming up, priming of neuromuscular pathways. This is just a fancy way of saying that you will get your mind, central nervous system, to connect with your body. See my nerve video for a little refresher on this system. As the brain sends messages to the spinal cord, which sends signals to the peripheral nerves, which then signal muscles to do work, the connections between all of these things get warmed up. The more connections that get warmed up, the faster you are going to react, and the more muscle you can recruit into your actions. Another term to throw out there is post-activation potentiation, PAP, or PAP. This is a phenomenon where muscular performance is improved for a short time after a person does maximal or near maximal effort with those muscles. Examples include doing short sprints, weighted jumps, box jumps, or squats. The benefits of the PAP have been shown in many studies, with some showing 2 to 5% increased power output. The best effects likely last 7 to 10 minutes within the exercise, but benefits may last up to 20 minutes. The training of neuromuscular pathways also reduces injury risk. An example of this is injury prevention protocols that utilize neuromuscular pathways. Injury prevention protocols specific to reducing anterior cruciate ligament, ACL injuries of the knee, work. Research shows a reduction in ACL injuries of over 50%. The last major benefit of warming up that I will talk about is the psychological benefit. Mental warm-ups have shown improved performance. At the end of this video, there is a recording of a mental warm-up that you can try. The warm-up process also allows for time to go through a routine, visualization processes, attentional focus, positive imagery, or psyching up. Whatever is your technique can be utilized during the process of warming up. Clearly, there's a benefit to warming up. What are the components of warming up? Most of you who have done any sort of sport already have an idea, but let's go into some details. There is stretching. Stretching is helpful at improving range of motion. There is a big difference between static stretching and dynamic stretching. Static stretching is putting your muscles, tendons on a stretch and then holding it, allowing for things to loosen up. On the other hand, dynamic stretching, moving through or even bouncing through range of motion. Research shows that static stretching of muscles immediately before using those muscles hurts the athletic performance of those muscles. Crazy, right? For some of you, this may completely change the way you do things. Another important component of warming up is the timing of things. How long to warm up and how soon before the competition? Well, the body starts warming quickly during the process of warming up. Within 3 to 5 minutes of exercise, with a maximum temperature being reached 10 to 20 minutes into the process. Unfortunately, after stopping the warm-up, you will start to rapidly cool off, where 15 to 30 minutes later, the benefits of muscle warming are gone. Let's also address some pitfalls of warming up. One, you can overheat. Heating may be helpful to muscle metabolism up to a point, but other organs do not like being hot, and this can hinder overall performance. Two, a warm-up that is too hard or too long can deplete important energy stores needed for the competition or temporarily weaken muscles. Three, too short of a warm-up or too long of a transition between the warm-up and competition eliminates many of the benefits of warming up. And four, static stretching, as I mentioned, can hurt muscle performance if done excessively. So, our ideal warm-up is going to look something like this. Dynamic stretching, motion to warm the body, post-activation potentiation, and staying warm. The duration of the warm-up should be 10 to 15 minutes. Any stretching should be at the beginning, and the post-activation potentiation should be towards the end. Try to have less than 15 minutes transition to competition. If transition is greater than 15 minutes, then 2 minutes of simulated sport or other warm-up is recommended. If the transition is going to be 30 minutes, then 5 minutes of simulated sport or warming up is recommended. Warm garments can help prolong muscle warmth. I strongly recommend keeping the feet, hands, and face exposed to keep the core from overheating. As always, there is no cookie cutter approach to warm-ups. Do what works for you. Your coach or trainer can help. Results vary by body type, sport, and training level. With time and some experimentation, you will find what works best for you. Use this video as a starting point. This video could potentially reduce my workload as an orthopedic surgeon. You know what? I hope so. My goal as an orthopedic surgeon is to see people use their bodies in the best way possible. To see people achieve their goals and overcome obstacles is wonderful. So remember, let's keep moving. Get after it. All right, you made it this far. Give this a chance. Here's an example of a mental warm-up. Get in a comfortable position. Here we go. Stand tall with your knees bent slightly and your feet shoulder width apart. Breathe through your nose and inhale, filling first the lower part of your lungs, then the middle part, finally the upper part. Hold the breath for a few seconds and exhale slowly, relaxing your abdomen and chest. Take another deep breath through your nose, inhale again, filling the lower part of your lungs, then the middle part, and finally, the upper part. As before, hold the breath for a few seconds and exhale slowly. relaxing your abdomen and chest. Resume breathing normally. You can use deep breathing to calm yourself as needed. If your mind wanders, becomes anxious, breathe. Now take a moment to get a clear mental picture of the main thing you want to accomplish. You can close your eyes as you think about something that is within your control. What do you see in this mental picture of what you want to accomplish? What sensations do you notice in your body? What do you feel in your muscles? What sounds do you hear? What smells and tastes do you notice? Make the mental picture as clear and vivid as you can. Now, let the mental picture fade and focus again on your breathing. Stand tall with your knees bent slightly and your feet shoulder width apart. Breathe through your nose and inhale, filling first the lower part of your lungs, then the middle part, and finally the upper part. Hold the breath for a few seconds and exhale slowly, relaxing your abdomen and chest. Now bring back the mental picture of the main thing you hope to accomplish today. As the clear and vivid mental picture of what you hope to accomplish reappears, what do you see? What sensations do you notice in your body? What do you feel in your muscles? What sounds do you hear? What smells and tastes do you notice? Allow yourself to fully experience this mental picture, filled with the belief that you can make it happen today. Let the mental picture fade once again. Imagine a warm glow forming in your stomach, right in your core. This warm glow is full of energy and is slowly starting to spread throughout your body. As the energy spreads, jump up and land with both feet. Shake out your arms and feel the energy starting to surge again from inside you. Feel the energy launch you into the air again. Land and shake out your arms. Keep that feeling of energy, and as you do, bring back the mental picture of the main thing you hope to accomplish today one final time. Check your energy level. Use the warm glow of energy in your body to raise your energy level, or your breathing to find the level of energy you need to get yourself ready to perform. You have the appropriate level of energy. You know what you want to accomplish. You believe you can accomplish it, and you are ready to do it. On the count of three, we will clap our hands three times and then go do it. One, two, three.